Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Give him praise. Declare him as the only true God. The one who knows all things. The one who is able to do all things. The beginning and the end. The God who is mighty in battle. Just go ahead and worship him this morning in your own words. Declare him as the only true God. Lord, we just honor you this morning. With our lives and our praise, we exalt you. We exalt you. We exalt you. We exalt you. We magnify you, Lord Jesus. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for your mercy, for your grace, for your loving kindness. Thank you for protection, preservation. Thank you for guidance, Lord. Thank you. Lord, we worship you. Lord, we worship you. We worship you. We worship you. We worship you. Lord, we worship you. We worship you. We declare your sovereignty. Oh, that it be exalted, be exalted, be exalted, be exalted, be exalted, be exalted. Thank you. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Just worship him this morning. Just worship him as an individual. Just exalt him. Magnify him in your own way. Magnify him. Magnify him. Magnify him. Oh, that they will thank you. That they will thank you. That they will thank
you. I will declare you are the only God. The only God.
There is good news for somebody here. It doesn't matter how troubled the waters are, you will swim to shore. I don't know you. No matter how troubled the waters are, you will swim to shore. In the mighty name of Jesus, it doesn't matter how endless those troubles might appear. You will get over them. You will not be drowned in the mighty name of Jesus. No matter for how many years they've been there, the God of heaven says to you, you will survive them. Every man who has laughed at you, they will come to laugh with you. In the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. Glory and honor to you, Lord. Lord, speak to every heart today in the mighty name of Jesus. Let your blessings rest upon us. Let the glory of the latter house surpass the former in our lives in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we lift up our eyes unto you, God. Our help is from you. Holy Spirit, help us this morning in the name of Jesus. We pray that your word will have great impact in our lives in the mighty name of Jesus. We declare this atmosphere for miracles, for healings, for deliverance, for salvation in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, none will stand in your way. None will hinder you from doing that which you have proposed for us today in the mighty name of Jesus. We plead the blood of Jesus for mercy. Thank you because you have heard us. Praise and glory to you, Lord. For in Jesus' name, we have prayed. God bless you. Please be seated. Thank God for yet another opportunity to come into His presence. Sammy says, I was glad when they said to me, let us go to the house of the Lord. You are only glad if you are going to a place where you know that when you get there, it's joy, it's blessedness, it's hope. And that's why we are happy always that we're in the presence of the Almighty God. Again, you are welcome to church. For those who are online, you are welcome. God bless you. We thank God for the theme, which has been, what is God saying to us? You know, through the scriptures, you'll find that God, using all manner of animals, describing things, speaking to our hearts, sending us messages through all of the various descriptions that we have of the scriptures of those animals. And that's why in 1 Corinthians 1:27, it says he uses the foolish things of this world to confirm the wise. In other words, some of those things that the wise are taught the other way. Bible says he uses those foolish things to confirm the wise. He said, and God has chosen the weak things of the world to confirm the things which are mighty. Which is why today we're looking at the hands. And thank God, it's God that have asked us to go to the hands and learn. How many of you have observed the hands? I mean, apart from killing them, you don't want them around you. But have you taken time to look at the hands truly, the way the scripture have instructed us to do? I'm about to do that again, even though some time ago, but now, yesterday again, I had to go to the ant so that when I stand there, I at least I'm saying that truly I have gone to the ant. But it is not that God is saying, go and sit and be watching the ant and see. But there are great lessons you can pick from the life of the ant, as the scriptures rightly put it. God at creation meant for every man to walk. And I'm using man as generic. And that's why you find in Genesis 2:15, the first thing that God did was he gave man work to do. He gave him the Garden of Eden and he told him, tend this garden, work this garden, make sure that this garden produces, make sure that you keep it orderly, don't mess around with it. It was only after this particular episode that God began to think of a wife for Adam. It was not before. And I've asked the question, why? Of course, we talk about helpmeet. You only need help when you have work that you are doing. If you don't have work, if you are jobless, if you are not doing anything, you really don't need help for being jobless. No. But God, in His mercy, saw the need for help for Adam after that He had commissioned him to do a work. Now that's the talk for another day. We're not teaching marriage. But note that God at creation meant for every one of us to be occupied doing one work or the other. So if you are not working, not because you cannot work. I mean, some people cannot work. They have some form of, for some reasons, deformities and all the like. But that you are a fully grown man, a fully formed woman, and you are not working, then you are working directly against the scriptures. Because what God says is that work. He said he gave Adam work. He gave him work. And if you look at the Luke 19 that we read, Luke 19, you see, Jesus, in confirming that, look, don't be lazy. Don't bring up vain philosophies and put yourself at a disadvantaged position. He said, occupy till I come. Get down to something. Be busy. Don't be lazy. Because when you do that, you run against the scriptures. You are robbing God. That's what the scriptures say. You know why? When Malachi 3 talked about those who are robbing God, you fall in that category. Because if you don't work, how would you generate tithe to pay God? So you're already robbing God. When you have no work to do, there is no income that allows you to be able to pay your tithes. What have you done? You have robbed God. Not only have you robbed God, you have not bothered about the faith. Because when you cannot, he said, bring all the tithes and the offering to my storehouse so that there will be the need of the house of God will be met. You are not in that category. You are not in that number. So you're already working against the plan of God at creation. There are always two categories of people. Those who cannot walk. And we also have some who will not walk. Not because they cannot walk, but they just will not walk. Haven't you seen such people? All around. In fact, unfortunately, with the situation of the country, it's at the increase now. Sometimes you have to be careful how you pick your phones these days. Because all that people are now asking all around the place, yes, there is famine in the land, there is difficulty in the land. But when you are coming to God and you are asking for an increase, 0 times 100 is what? If you come with an empty hand and you are asking that God should increase you, we pray for increase, we pray for enlargement, we pray, and you are praying thus with an empty hand, there is nothing to be increased. Nothing. There cannot be an increase. A lazy man has no place in God. You have no place with God. Even Jesus, when he was with us here on earth, he walked up to the death on the cross. Is it praying? Is it deliverance? Is it healing? Is it evangelism? He walked. So why will you not walk? Which was why he said, occupy till I come. Occupy till I come. Proverbs 15:19 says, a lazy person's way is blocked. Say, a lazy person's way is blocked with prayers. When you are lazy, you cannot get through things. Things cannot work for you. You know, it's so painful. Those of us who go around, you notice, in fact, when economists are speaking, they say the reason why they measure the prosperity of a nation by the percentage of youth that you have is because it is assumed that the youth have what? Strength to work. So they should contribute to the GDP of that country. So the prosperity of a nation can actually be equal to the percentage of the workforce, those who are still in the labor market and are working. So they measure them and say, okay, this country will be prosperous because, but in our own case in Nigeria, we have the youth. I can't remember the last percentage down. But even at that, you find that yet, there's what? There's poverty in the land. All around the place. It says a lazy man's way is blocked. He can't get things done. He can't get things through. Look at it, 19:15 of the same Proverbs. 19:15. It says, lazy people sleep soundly. You know why? Because when others have gone, that's when they start their sleep. Have you noticed? That's when they close the door. That's when they get the duvet and then cover. In fact, when you get up, some of us who have been opportune to grow up with some of our mates, you know, when you are getting up in the morning, those days, and you are rushing out to work 5 a.m., 6 a.m. to join the bus at the gate, that's the time they change position. When they change position, they take the duvet or whatever cover and they cover their head so that you don't, the noise of your dressing up does not even disturb them. He said they sleep sound. But idleness, we do what? We leave them hungry. Go and check. That's why some people's lives have not amounted to anything. It's laziness. And unfortunately, it's on the increase now. Go and check. Part of the reasons for divorce rate that we're seeing all around us. Go and check. I've not been able to put figure to, but I observe. Part of the list, go and check the list. You will find out that one of them, either of the couple, have refused to work. Don't just say, I'm not working. Lazing around. It says, the path is blocked. He said they cannot get things done. And so when he told us about the hand in Proverbs 6, he described who the sluggard or the slothful person is. He says, it's someone who is lazy, unconcerned. He doesn't have a feeling about what happens the next morning. His conscience cannot program the fact that this thing, I cannot continue like this. Lazy. Lazy in thinking. Lazy in being productive. Lazy in being able to achieve anything. Go and check. Once a man is lazy, it affects every area of his life. What men will see as gold, he will see it as stone. It will not amount to anything. He will not see it as something that can be of any value. God, I mean, so kind. Bible described in 1 Corinthians 12, verse 4 to 12, how that God looked at every one of us at creation and put in us what is required of every one of us to profit in this part of eternity. He put it there. He said, he gave everyone, is given to every man to profit. You are supposed to profit from it. And that's why the Luke 19 that we read, he brought all of them together. And he gave them 10 pounds each. And he came back to ask of them, that come, I gave you this. What have you done with it? I'm praying for you. You know, the latter part of that scripture, the last verse, the verse 27, please give us the verse 27. It says, but those, my enemies, it described them as what? May you not be the enemy of God in Jesus' name. If you are not using the gift of God, if you are not walking according to the scriptures, if you are not walking with your hands, if you are lazing around, you are an enemy of God. He said, which will not that I should reign over them. He said what? Bring them. And do what? Slay them before me. It's terrible how our young men and women these days go around lazy. In fact, sometimes when you even have the opportunity to bring some of them to interview panels, you are shocked at their mental capacity. Those who have gone, that claims to have gone to school, and you are asking yourself, God, what is it? I mean, it's not that they were not taught in school. You know, nobody looks for head knowledge when you are not looking for head knowledge. You are looking for those who can apply knowledge. That's what you are looking for. And when they come, you cannot see that, they cannot display that to you. That's failure. And they are all around. There are so many jobs looking for people to do it. But there are not many people available to do it. It's sad. Haven't you noticed, for those who fly many times, go and check. You bought an aircraft going out of this country. 80% of those on that aircraft most times are going for what? Going for what? Vacation. Vacation. And then when you are coming back, you also then see that 80% of foreigners who are on the aircraft are coming to do what? Business. Business. That's what they are coming here to do. And yet, everyone that sees a Nigerian outside of this place, that they are usually very happy. Haven't you noticed? We're the only people that knows how to spend. Everything about us is cash. Cash. Even when it's a cashless society, you would have thought that by now, naira in circulation, but we still go around. Even when you carry cash and you are doling cash all around. Yet we are lazy. Chinese man said they are always coming because they know that whatever it is, whatever is produced and brought into this environment, gains what? Value for it. Shouldn't that bother us? Everything that is brought to this environment finds value. Everything. May we not be sluggards in Jesus' name. So he talked about the hands. And he said, one of the things about the hands is that they are driven by purpose. They are driven by purpose. Jeremiah 29:11 was clear about it. There is a purpose for every individual's life. Peradventure, it is because you don't know that purpose that you are lazy about it. Go back to God and ask God for your purpose on this path of eternity. Let God reveal it to you. He said, there is a purpose for you. He said, I have a purpose for you. Hands are driven by purpose. Drop a crumb of bread anywhere in the house. What happened? The hands will locate it. Put it under your pillow. Put it by your gas cooker. The hands will do what? The hands will locate it. They are driven by purpose. The one that has been commissioned to look for food will do what? Look for food everywhere food can be found. And that's what God expects of us. Whether it is in winning souls, wherever souls are perishing, God expects every one of us to locate it and go there and do what? Bring the soul. Haven't you noticed? If ants that pick that crumb of bread is going, carrying the crumb of bread and is going, and you distract or tries to kill the hand, haven't you noticed that the moment that crumb of bread drops, the other one is waiting to pick it around, and immediately he picks it. Even if you do the same thing that you did to the first one, the third one is waiting. They are what? They are driven by purpose. What you do on a daily basis, is it driven by purpose? That's the only way you can get results. The hands, they work as a team. They work as if every one of them, they have what to do. The one that will carry, you know why they also fall? Even if you don't distract them, haven't you also noticed? If you are, when that one gets tired, it drops it. And then the other one does. The one that is following picks it. And the journey continues until they take it. to where they are going to. They work as a team. When we work as a team, we get, in fact, one of the things that was said, I think it was Taylor, one of those management, he said, productivity is achieved when jobs are broken down. Greater measure of productivity is achieved when jobs are broken down. Why? Because somebody else picks it from where you have stopped, if you have done a very good job, and it goes on and on, and before you know it, productivity is achieved. Don't be lazy. Even in the church, that home fellowship you belong to, that group you belong to, that unit you belong to, work with them as a team. And you will achieve greater measure of what God demands of us in this part of eternity. Ants, they work efficiently. Very, very efficient. They don't wait to be told what to do. Even though they don't have supervisors like some of us have, every ant knows what to do. They have a work. They don't wake up and not have work to do. The ones who are supposed to prepare food goes out and look, scavenge wherever the food is, and they bring it back. Can we think of our life that way? That every day you take stock of your life and you're saying to yourself, have I actually added value to my life in this day? Or have subtracted from the value that I carried over to that particular day? If you live your life that way, you will soon discover that you can do much more than you currently do. Or that you can achieve much more than you currently are achieving. They work so efficiently. They work for the future. They do not lack. In fact, the Bible says they pile up. You read that they pile up their food in summer. Because they know that when the rainy season comes, it's not the time to go out. Brethren, there is the summer of every life. And that's why the scripture says, walk, why it is what? Yet day. He said, because the night comes when you will not be able to do any work. And in case you have missed out on your summer of the youthful age, as long as you live, there is hope for you. You can pick it up again. You can start this day. Don't be lazy. God did not design you to be lazy. The investment of God in you, you can't afford to waste it. You can't afford to waste it. How do you recognize a Christian sluggard? Someone who is slothful. A Christian. There are people who they lack vision. They lack zeal. And so, what usually happens is that whatever comes their way, they are the people that will tell you whatever will be. And now, it's a lazy man's talk. Whatever will be, will be. Why don't you make it to be what you want it to be? Rather than wait for it to be whatever will be, will be. No, that cannot be for a Christian. The Bible says, the thought that I have for they are thought of good and not of evil, to bring you to an expected end. So it cannot be a case of whatever will be. No, reject it. Wake up in the morning. As you get up, claim the day for your good. It's not accidental that God has brought you to that day. So you cannot assume that whatever will be. No. Cannot be. There are people who will tell you, I'm too busy to study the Bible. I'm too busy to go for midweek service. We'll stay back. That old job. They will have every reason not to do what is expected of them to do. They are religious fanatic. You know why? They come up with vain philosophies for whatever it is that they are not able to. They will tell you, some can even tell you that God asked them not to work. The question is, where did God, why God who commissioned work will now tell them not to work? And they will tell you, they will show you scriptures to back why they are not doing whatever they are not doing. Religious fanatics, very lazy, but they can give you reasons why they are not doing whatever they are supposed to do. They are there, they are in the church. Amongst us, in the church. Brethren, every labor has a profit. Every labor. There is profit for it. Proverbs 4:23. It says, in all labor, there is profit. It says, Proverbs 14:23. It says, in all labor, there is profit. He didn't describe what labor it should be. He didn't say, if you knot a tie, wear a jacket, and go to work every morning, there is profit for it. No. He said, in all labor, there is what? There is profit. So whatever you do, there is what? There's profit for it. Get out to work. It brings you joy and happiness when you have a job, you have a work that you are doing. You are not lazy. Psalm 128 verse 2. It brings you joy and happiness. He said, for thou shalt eat the labor of thy hands. And so if you are not working and you are eating, you know, that the second Thessalonians that we read, in fact, I was saying to myself, I said, this brother Paul can be very hard. Very, very hard. You know, he was telling them, he said, we have not been lazy amongst you. He said, if you find an idle man amongst you, he said, do what? Part way with him. He said, part way with him. Why? Because soon it will bring such idleness upon you. It will draw you to himself. They are very, very good at bringing people around them. Very loving, very, they know how to get their people men pleasers. Why? In any case, they have no job they are doing. So, it brings joy, it brings happiness. It gives you the opportunity to be able to help others. When they call for help for others, it is when you have a job that you are doing that is bringing profit to you that you can help others. Otherwise, you will not be of any help to the church. And 1 Timothy 5:8 talks about the fact that when you are jobless, when you don't bring something to the home, when you don't bring something to the table, it says, if you cannot provide for yourself, if all you do is to scavenge all around the place, said, and even especially for your household, if you now have house, said, you have denied the faith. Give us NLT of this scripture. Say, you have denied the faith. He said, but those who won't care for their relatives, especially those in their own household, have denied the true faith. Such people are what? What's the unbelievers? They don't belong to the faith that we're talking about. Don't let yourself be caught up in this. And finally, let's look at the end product of a slothful person. Where do they usually end up? Proverbs 10:4. Proverbs 10:4. Said it becometh poor that deals with a slack hand. But the hand of the diligent does what? Make rich. In other words, increase will come to your hand. You can't come with an empty hand and expect increase to come. There's no increase that can come to a zero point. No increase. Don't be engaged in motion at a spot and say that you are moving forward. Forward where? Don't. It's against the principles of the scriptures. In fact, it's against the principles of life. It says you will end up in poverty and in want. They end up in disappointment and frustration. Proverbs 13:4. He said, the soul of the sluggard desired and had nothing. He said, but the soul of the diligent shall be what? Shall be made fat. Only the soul of the diligent can be made fat. The soul of the lazy man cannot be made fat. Nothing can bring increase to that slothful man. That's what the scripture is saying. He says, so don't put yourself in that position. Don't get yourself frustrated. A lot of people are frustrated today because they have wasted their summer time. They have useless. I mean, you know, there's this new word I learned in the course of this. It's an Igbo word. He said, they are a fool. A fool what? A fool. Who is an a fool? Ma? He said, worthless. Useless is not good for anything. In fact, somebody described for that. He said, an a fool is man who throws away the machete, and then the shield for the machete is the one he's using to clear the bush. Abba, say to your neighbor, don't be an a fool. Praise the Lord. They end up in decay. A slothful man ends up in decay. Ecclesiastes 10:18. It said, by much slothfulness, the building decays. And through idleness of the house does God. Drop. Don't be idle. Find something to do. And as you find that, then you can pray for the increase of God to come upon it. You don't sleep. You don't stay in your house sleeping and be expecting that even if miracle is going to happen, miracle will happen as you position yourself for the miracle to take place. Hallelujah. So they end up in shame and disgrace. Proverbs 10:5. He that gathereth in summer is a wise son. But he that sleepeth in harvest is a son that does what? That causes shame. Say, I will not bring shame to my family. I will not bring shame to my household. It will not. You see, if they are looking at those who are frustrated or brought whatever evil to wherever, my name may not be mentioned there. Never. It will not happen as the Lord liveth. Finally, they end up in deep sleep and they suffer hunger. Proverbs 19:15. It says, slothfulness cast into a sleep, a deep sleep, and an idle soul. 19:15, I said. 19:15. Are you saying there's no 19:15? Okay. This one has refused to change. Pardon me. Slothfulness casts into a deep sleep, and an idle soul shall do what? Suffer hunger. Now, we want to pray. 2 Thessalonians, chapter 3, take us to verse 9. Verse 9. Okay, 10, 11, 12. He said, now, them that are such, we command and exhort you by our Lord Jesus Christ that with quietness they walk and eat their own bread. 13. But ye brethren, Be not weary in well-doing. 14. If any man obey not our word by this epistle, note that man. And do what? And have no company with him. Why? Why? Shame comes to him who is lazy. In fact, second name down the line is shame. Third name down the line is frustration. Because they will tell you all manner of things. They are the ones that are quick to bring judgment to situations and circumstances around them. And they blame it on just about anything. I pray that you will not be in that category in the name of Jesus. You will not be slothful in business. The increase of God that you are talking about will come to that which you have in your hands in the mighty name of Jesus. But I tell you this, except God renews our mind, except salvation comes, some of these things, you will never understand it. Because really, why would a man wake up and just think that covering himself with duvet and sleeping when others are rushing out to do something? Why would a man? Jesus is the only one that can deliver. And so if you have not given your life to Christ, you are denying the faith. You are worse than an unbeliever. That's what the scripture says. And so if you are here, you want to surrender your life to Jesus before we pray. Finally, just all heads bow now. Just lift up your hand. Let's pray with you quickly and get done with you before we pray for ourselves. Is there anyone? You want to surrender your life to Jesus? Quickly, you want to be born again. You want to say, Lord, here I come. I don't want to live a life of slothfulness. I don't want to deny the faith anymore. Okay, the rest of us, we're going to pray. I want you to rise because we want to pray for ourselves. Let's rise. You are going to pray just one prayer point and say, Lord, this work of my hand, let your increase come to it. I am working. I need your increase to come upon this work of my hands. I need enlargement. I need expansion. I need growth in this work that I do. In this business that I run. Let the story change, oh God. Let there be an expansion. Let there be increase in it. Take away every form of idleness. Men who are working with me and are draining from the work that I do. By being idle, they come to work. They leave their homes and come to work. But yet they are not coming to add value. They are taken out of the value of the place. Pray and say, Lord, separate me from such men. The scripture says, separate yourself from such men. Pray and say, Lord, separate me from such men. Men that are idle, that will not add value, but take away value. Separate me from them. Even if I've gone into a deep friendship with them, cut that friendship now. And let them go away from me. Let me go away from them. Let our way part so that value can come to me.
This is a serious prayer. Pray something great into your life now. Pray something unique into your life. Things that is going to tie you down and will not make you to be profitable in life. Let it be taken away from you. Separate me from it. Let the work of my hand bring profit to me. With the work you do spiritually, the work you do in the physical, in your place of work, in your business, God, let it be profitable in my life. Let it be profitable to me. Whatever is surrounding me that will not make me to be profitable, Lord, separate me from them. I must make input into the work of the kingdom. I must make input into the work of the kingdom. They won't take my own portion and give it to the one that has ten profits. The one that went to hide his own, God asked them to take the master said, take it from him, give it to the one that has made profit of 10. My portion will not be given to the one that has made profit. Lord, make me profitable. Make my life profitable. Make my life profitable. Every idleness in my life, take it away from me. A little sleep, a little slumber. Makes a man to become poor. God, take away poverty from me. Make me to be useful. Make me to be useful. Never be idle again in life. Pray for yourself. Pray for yourself. This prayer is very key. It's whatever you pray down the line for yourself that will come to manifest even in your life in the future. Pray it now. Pray it now. I want you to pray for the speaker that the Lord will bless the works of his hand. The same that he has ministered unto us today will be a blessing upon his own life too. That the work of his hand, God will cause him to be profitable and it will be a blessing to him. Just the same way you are praying for yourself, pray for the servant of God that ministered the word of God to us this morning. That the power of God will continually work upon his life. That which you do on a daily basis, that the hand of the Lord will bless it. We bless it. Pray for enlargement for him. Pray for increase for him. Thank you, Father. We return all the glory to you, Lord. Father, we thank you for the word we have received today. Lord, we know that this word has come to us expressly from the throne. Father, we ask you, God, let this word continually speak to us as we walk on a daily basis, and we shall continually see the goodness of God in that which we do. In the name of Jesus Christ. Father, Lord God, we ask you, God, that according to your word, that the lines are falling unto us in pleasant places. Lord, in our places of work, in that which we do, Father, let good lines be falling unto us in our works, in pleasant places, in the name of Jesus Christ. Father, every form of idleness and laziness, take it off from your people, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord Father. We return the glory to you. Thank you for your servant you have used this morning. May increase be upon his life, in the name of Jesus. We return the glory to you, Lord Father. In Jesus' mighty name we have prayed. Amen. God bless you. Please be seated.